few years back, I was able to go with my brother to a fishing trip on what's called the Boundary Waters on the edge of Minnesota and Canada. And it was 4 days and three nights of canoeing and camping and fishing, and it was glorious. But on the first evening, my brother said to my nephew and I, he said, "Okay, guys, we need to finish dinner and get in our tents because the mosquitoes come out about 9 o'clock. And even with permethrin-soaked clothing and bug spray on, you don't want to be outside." And so we did. We nodded in agreement. We got done. We got in our tents. Unfortunately, my stomach, still adjusting to camp cooking, didn't get the memo. And I had to visit the open-air outhouse soon after getting into my tent. And long story short, I know what it feels like to be a pepperoni pizza at a youth group lock-in. I am surprised I had enough blood left even to make it back to the tent. Even my mosquito bites had mosquito bites. And I think the only ones that didn't bite me were the ones I had accidentally inhaled. But for those 3 minutes and the itchy hours that followed, I was absolutely miserable. And I made sure the following evening that I was completely prepared for tent time. Which prompts the question from me in my mind, did God actually create those miserable little biters? Or were they a consequence of the fall? I wish I could share with you a testimony of faith, a lesson that I learned, but honestly, the last thing on my mind at that moment was rejoicing in the Lord's creation, His insect creation. But I thought, you know, at least I had a tent to escape to. At least I had bug spray to help keep them off of me, and hydrocortisone and Benadryl to keep me from scratching my flesh off. Imagine being in Egypt for the third plague. In Egypt for the third plague. Exodus chapter 8, verses 16 through 19. Just four verses today, which is good because that means it'll be a shorter sermon. Shorter passage equals shorter sermon. But Exodus chapter 8, verses 16 through 19. "The Lord said to Moses, 'Say to Aaron, stretch out your staff and strike the dust of the earth, so that it may become gnats in all the land of Egypt.' And they did so. Aaron stretched out his hand with his staff and struck the dust of the earth, and there were gnats on man and beast. All the dust of the earth became gnats in all the land of Egypt. The magicians tried by their secret arts to produce gnats, but they could not. So there were gnats on man and beast. Then the magician said to Pharaoh, 'This is the finger of God.' But Pharaoh's heart was hardened, and he would not listen to them, as the Lord had said." Our main idea for this morning is this: the Lord alone is God over the earth and sky. The Lord alone is God over the earth and sky. We continue to follow the interpretation that the Lord is teaching Israel and Egypt, and indeed even us, about His sovereignty. Yahweh is humiliating all of Egypt's false gods and their pagan religious practices. He's establishing Himself, especially in the eyes of Israel, as the one true and living God, the only one worthy of worship. And that was a lesson that they would struggle with, actually, for the rest of their existence. But this is a lesson they need and we need to constantly be brought back to. The Lord alone is God over the earth and sky. So let's pause and have a word of prayer that God would speak to us through these four verses. Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your word and these lessons of Your sovereignty from this narrative about Your plagues that You displayed in Egypt to rescue Israel, showing Yourself mighty, redeeming them and humiliating all the false gods, the gods that are no gods in the world. And we pray again as we study this that You would remind us of your sovereignty over our lives, and indeed that all our petty idols would fall down and be broken in the light of your glorious name and your glorious work in our life. You alone are God and worthy of praise. Give us practical insight about what this means, what this passage and what this scripture means to us in our lives today. We pray through the power of your Holy Spirit, in the name of Jesus. Amen. I divide this passage very simply into two. Verses 16 and 17, we see that repeated phrase, the dust of the earth, the dust of the earth. And so that's kind of what I've titled that first section. And I haven't mentioned before that the plagues are organized into patterns. In fact, patterns of three. For example, plagues 1, 4, and 7, Pharaoh is given a warning while by the Nile River. He's by the Nile River when Pharaoh is warned. For plagues 2, 5, and 8, Pharaoh is given a warning while in his palace. But for plagues 3, 6, and 9, no warning is given at all. The plague just descends without warning. Then, of course, the 10th plague stands alone because it is God's finale in the land of Egypt. So we see in this third episode that the plague descends without warning upon Egypt. The Lord instructs Moses and Aaron again to use that staff to strike something. Previously it was the Nile. Now, this time, it's the dust of the earth. In fact, the phrase dust of the earth occurs three times in those two verses. And notice also the repeated phrase, in all the land of Egypt. And repetition is important. It makes sense to me then that if the Lord is specifically targeting an Egyptian false god, it probably has something to do with the earth, the land, the dust, possibly the sky, because gnats or mosquitoes or what have you, generally in the realm of the air, but either the land or the sky. Of course, we need to be cautious because it's not specifically stated in the scriptures. But if it is possible that there are gods in mind here, the Egyptian god Set, god of the earth, might be a candidate. Or perhaps Nut or Hathor, both sky goddesses. It's possible. In the end, we don't know because it's not in the scriptures. It doesn't really matter because the Lord is showing Himself as sovereign over everything and everyone in Egypt. For Moses, the competition is not even worth naming because there is no competition with the Lord. But this appears to be directed towards the dust of the earth. And they turn into gnats or mosquitoes. What are these critters? Some translations say gnats like mine or mosquitoes or fleas. The word could refer to any two-winged biting insect. So take your pick. And even though my superlative ESV says gnats, I like to think of them as mosquitoes because they are by far the most annoying and indeed dangerous of all blood-sucking insects. But Moses says all the dust of the ground became gnats. That's what we call in scriptures hyperbole. Or if you grow up a redneck like me, hyperbole. Exaggeration for effect. It's not necessarily literal. It's kind of like we would say they were so thick you couldn't even see through them. Something like that. Just absolutely thick in the air. Now, is it possible that God physically turned dust into gnats? Of course, God can do whatever He wants. But the point is to show how tremendously vast and supernatural this plague was. I recall someone talking recently about maybe not a plague, but a bug infestation so bad here in Hannibal that at one time the bridge was so covered with them that they would have accidents on the bridge because it was so slick, all the bugs being smushed. I mean, that's kind of the idea. They're just everywhere. If you can imagine picking up handfuls of dust or sand and just throwing them up into the air and having them turn into biting bugs, that's the imagery. Dust of the earth. And again, no bug spray, no permethrin, no hydrocortisone. It must have been a miserable experience. So much so that the magicians of Egypt say, "This is the finger of God." Let's look at verses 18 and 19, which I have labeled the finger of God. Again, the focus falls on these Egyptian magicians, and there's been kind of a contest going back and forth between Moses and these Egyptians. And their efforts to offer some kind of response to this plague. And at some level, they were able to turn water into something that looked like blood, bloody-looking liquid before. And they were able to produce frogs on a small scale, at least enough to convince Pharaoh not to let the people go. But I mean, here we have millions of tiny little mosquitoes. Have you ever heard of Houdini or David Copperfield doing a trick with mosquitoes? I mean, a flea circus really isn't that impressive, is it? Especially when the whole land is full of them. And like I've said before, if these charlatans really had any power, they would have been able to reverse the plagues. But they were not. It says that in verse 18. They were not. This miracle they couldn't even imitate on a small scale. So the magicians throw up their hands in frustration and confess, "This is the finger of God." The finger of God. That's an interesting phrase. Scholars label this a literary device called synecdoche. So don't say you didn't learn something today. Synecdoche. Where an entity's feature, like an appendage or something, is indicative of that whole entity's power. So we would kind of say it, we would think of it this way. From the Egyptians' perspective, this miracle that we weren't even able to imitate, God was able to do with his little finger. God was able to do with even with his little finger. It's a sign of God's authority and sovereignty and power. It's an admission of failure, an acknowledgement of defeat, an acknowledgement of the Lord's superiority. They weren't necessarily converted, but they were defeated. Now, what's more significant even than that is the contrast, again, between these Egyptian magicians and Pharaoh. Pharaoh's best wizards are convinced that this plague is nothing less than supernatural, the very finger of God. But what does Pharaoh say? He is stubbornly hard-hearted. "Yeah, it's nothing. It's nothing." Pharaoh's hard heart is again on full display in bold and italics, just like the Lord had predicted. Pharaoh is rejecting the will of God and he's not letting the people go. And I thought about this contrast between these magicians and Pharaoh, seeing all this evidence before them and their perspectives. Isn't it strange in life how some things can be so crystal clear to some people, and yet others who are exposed to the same evidence can't see what's as plain as the nose of their face? I bet you and I have experienced that in our lives. I immediately thought of this issue we see in our culture today, this issue of late-term abortion and infanticide. There are legislatures, usually at the state level now, that are driving through and arguing over whether a fully formed baby in the womb or even outside of the womb should be terminated. And if you have any sense of humanity or reasonable morality, you know that killing a fully formed infant inside or outside of the womb is morally reprehensible. And yet, there are even Christians who are defending such ideas. Is that a knowledge issue? Is that an evidence issue? No. It's a heart issue. In some cases, it's a money issue, honestly, because government's involved. But it's a heart issue. Just like Pharaoh, they have hard hearts that are blind to real compassion, blind to the things of God. And that's what we see going on here. Pharaoh is blinded by his own heart. A couple applications, and we'll close with an illustration. I noticed this from the text as well and from the scriptures in general. Witnessing the miraculous doesn't necessarily build faith or soften the heart. Witnessing the miraculous doesn't necessarily build faith or soften the heart. There's kind of this idea in religion that, well, you know, if God would just show up in some miraculous way, maybe a dramatic healing or some act over nature, then I'd really have faith. Then I'd really believe, and my faith would really grow. But what happens in the scripture? What happens in the life of Jesus? How many miracles did he perform that were witnessed by the scribes and the Pharisees? And like Moses, they didn't believe. In fact, in some cases, their hearts were more hardened because of the miracle. They wanted to kill him more and hated him more. And what does the Bible say actually builds faith? Where does faith come from? You may think of Romans 10:17 like I did. Faith comes from hearing, hearing through the Word of Christ. It comes from the Bible. It comes from the Holy Spirit speaking to us from His Word. You want to have greater faith? Get deep into the Word of God. Bible study and strong authoritative preaching of the Word of God. There are so many, we have such great access to all kinds of resources now to digest the Word of God. We have apps that we can download on our phones and we can go online and hear messages and sermons and all kinds of things we have access to. I think of even Bot Radio Network that has recently been here in Hannibal. 93.3 on your FM dial is sermons all day long. Good Bible preaching. I don't always agree with everything they say. Of course, I'm right. But it's good Bible preaching. My radio's there all the time. That's ways to build your faith. It's not seeing some miraculous plague descend. It can help. Obviously, it could help. But think about the Israelites. Even for years after, they struggled to obey God, even seeing all these miracles. So witnessing the miraculous doesn't necessarily build faith or even soften the heart. But this next application is very important because I know it is 100% absolutely true. A lot of the things that I may say from the pulpit could be my own opinion, honestly. But when you quote Scripture, you know that it's true. Proverbs 4:23 says this, "Guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life." Guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. You can't read the story of the Exodus without soberly considering matters of the heart. And of course, I'm not talking about our blood-pumping organ, but the heart, the soul, the essence of a person that determines the course of our lives. Isn't created humanity an interesting thing, an astounding creation if you think about it? Science can't even explain it or properly describe it. Atoms and cells and electricity and chemicals all combine together, and yet there's an immaterial nature of our lives, an essence of being that the Scripture calls the heart, a soul made up of mind, will, and emotions. And I think, you know, some of us are more intellectual than others, but the heart is really where decisions are made. And mind is just a part of the heart. I'm convinced that most of us don't make up our minds about an issue. We make up our hearts about an issue. The heart is the direction of your life. And I did a study recently, a word study on the in the Bible about that word heart. And I categorized the usage of that word. And over 60 times in the Bible, over 60 times, the heart is used in a positive sense, meaning good things come from the heart. And the heart is good for praising and leads us to God, things like that. However, almost double that, 115 times or more, the Bible describes the heart in a negative sense. That is, that bad things can come from the heart. Over 115 times. And another category, however, I found over 125 times in the Bible some kind of imperative, some kind of warning in God's Word to watch over or guard your heart in some way. Not necessarily those specific words, but a warning regarding heart. Christian, are you guarding your heart? Pharaoh wasn't. He wasn't paying attention to his heart at all. You know, a person doesn't cognitively choose to be unfaithful to their spouse because of data. It's not like they formulate a little pie chart and say, maybe I should cheat on my spouse. That's not how it happens. A fellow doesn't sit down and contrast the benefits and detriments of embezzlement and arson. A choice like that is made in the heart. Even small life decisions are made from the heart, that complex combination of mind, will, and emotions. And the Word repeatedly says that we must continually bring our heart to God to have Him watch over our hearts and to guard our hearts, watch them with all our diligence. Guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. Especially, I found, in areas of worship. These plagues are really about worship. Who deserves Israel's worship? J.I. Packer writes, and I'll close with this illustration, this quote, "What other gods could we have besides the Lord? Well, plenty. For Israel, there were those Canaanite Baals, those jolly nature gods whose worship was a rampage of gluttony and drunkenness and ritual prostitution. For us, there are still the great gods of sex, shekels, and stomach." He calls that an unholy trinity constituting one God, self. And then there's the other enslaving trio, pleasure, possessions, and position, whose worship is described as the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life, from 1 John 2:16. Packer says, football, the firm, and family are also gods for some. Indeed, the list of other gods is endless, for anything that anyone allows to run his life becomes his god. Did you hear that? Anything that anyone allows to run his life becomes his god. And the claimants for this prerogative are legion. In the matter of life's basic loyalty, temptation is a many-headed monster. I've found that to be true in my life. You don't have to be total pagans to struggle with idolatry. We too can surrender to the draw of false gods. And that's the greater lesson of the Exodus. It's worth repeating. The Lord alone is God. He alone deserves our worship and allegiance. The Lord alone is God of the earth and the sky and everything, every aspect of our lives.